Hey there, Michael Church with Crawl Space Ninja, and I have with me today Todd Jackson. He is the co-founder of Fortress Stabilization Systems, and we're going to talk about basement walls and why do they bow. Stay tuned. Okay, so if you're new to Crawl Space Ninja, we talk about everything dealing with your attic, basement, crawl space, and ductwork. So make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and ring that notifications bell. All right, so I'm gonna be quiet now. I'm just gonna ask Todd a couple of questions and let him tell you why is your basement wall bowing in. Todd, take it away.
Very good question. Typically bowing would be CMUs or masonry units. CMU would be concrete masonry units or brick or clay, and typically bowing would be caused because there's no reinforcement and you're going to be teetering at the moment in between four points where the building's sitting on the actual foundation, and then you've got the weight of the foundation plus the dead and live load of the house in the two corners. And then in between those four is your actual pushing moment. And typically you'll get bowing more on an 8-inch CMU than you will a 12-inch. As we increase the actual thickness, you can have different cracking patterns. But typically on a CMU, which is why most of the country in the late 70s, early 80s started to go to poured walls, because you don't have the bowing with the poured walls. You'll have different cracking patterns, but you won't have that inward movement in between those four points. And so typically you're going to have your, a foundation is a beam below grade. And as a beam below grade, you basically have a compression push of the soil. So the inside is tension. So a push equals a pull. And so that's basically what's happening. Then when you get to the center with an 8-inch CMU, you will get bowing. And as I say, you'll still have the same moments on poured walls or on 12-inch CMU, but you'll have different cracking patterns in the way that they behave. Typically with poured walls, you're going to have more of a tipping and then 45 degree angle cracking as opposed to horizontal bending in the center.
Okay.
So even though your moments are the same, the behavior is going to be a little bit different based on the height of the wall, thickness of the wall, so on and so forth.
Okay, now keep in mind a CMU is a
concrete masonry unit.
We call it a cinder block. Okay, that's what we call it here in the South. So when he's talking about a CMU, he's talking about a cinder block. Now if you're up north, which where are you from again?
I am from Michigan.
You're from Michigan. All right, so you guys got a totally different language when it comes to us down here in the South.
Now actually, I've done a lot of work with cinder block. Cinder's been outlawed, I believe, even in the South, below grade, for over 30, 35 years. Cinder, this is interesting, and basically where they were producing coal, you had these leftover cinders.
Right.
And so somebody figured out, let's make masonry units out of it, right? And that's where the cinder blocks came from. But the cinder, you've got many oils in it, things of that. It's much weaker in compression than a CMU. So in most states, they went to a CMU to get away from the cinder.
So even though we call it a cinder block, it's not really a cinder block
because
it's not made of cinders.
It's made out of cement and aggregate as opposed to crushed cinders.
And we typically have an 8x16 standard around here.
Yep.
Now, let me ask you a couple of questions. Obviously, as far as the bowing, hydrostatic pressure, soil pressure is causing that. If builders would pour those cavities of the CMUs, if they would pour them full of concrete, would that decrease the bowing and the tipping, or would it increase tipping and decrease bowing? And please explain what tipping is also, but answer my original question first. I'm sorry, I'm asking you too many. I'm interviewing a politician. I'm asking you 9 questions and you're gonna maybe answer one. So first of all, would pouring the CMUs help with preventing bowing?
No.
No, okay.
A little bit. It would help more with compression, which is, we've got to remember foundations are designed to hold up the load of the building.
Okay.
Then they've got designed for basements for, well, if we got to go down 4 feet, we might as well go down 7 feet and add square footage and storage.
Right.
But the initial design of the foundation is to hold up the dead and live load of the building.
Not to keep the soil right. pressure, that's but correct. To hold the floor that's, above it. That's the original design right. of the wall.
That is correct. Now, but if you just poured a grout or concrete into the cavities, you would increase the compression dramatically. But because concrete has is not very good in tension.
Okay.
Typically, so you would still, it's like a pilaster. You would still end up cracking even with those cavities filled. What you'd want to do is add rebar to your grout.
Okay.
The reason why we're going to add rebar to the grout is because what the concrete or the grout lacks in tensile, that's where the steel comes in.
Okay.
So the proper way to do that would be grout and steel, not just grout.
Okay. So if you're building your house, you want to do grout and steel, not just let the contractor or the home builder talk you yeah. into just pouring sludge down into the
correct.
The cavities, all right?
Yeah.
Now, if you've already got your home built, what can a homeowner do to reinforce that without having to put steel in? Would a strap, a carbon fiber strap, be the answer to that situation?
That very well could. Typically, and first off, on residential, they very seldom want to put steel as opposed to commercial. Where you're going, we're doing a foundation in commercial, it's much different. We're going to be checking the slump of the concrete and the grout, and we're going to be placing our steel. Typically residential, they try to stay away from that. So most residentials, it's not, they don't have to put in steel, so the builder will leave the steel out.
I got you. So pouring, just to recap, pouring the concrete into the cavity of the cinder block, the CMU, is going to make this part stronger, but not this part stronger. So it'll hold more weight.
Right.
As gravity is forcing that down, but it's not going to do anything to keep the walls from bowing unless they put some steel.
Or if you added pilasters.
A pilaster.
So typically if we got an 8-inch wall, you'll see a design that came from the late 60s, early 70s was pilasters. So we've got an 8-inch wall, and then at a 12-foot section, they put in a 12-inch that acts as like a pilaster. The interesting thing about some of the pilasters is some of them aren't loaded. So in other words, they're adding depth to, obviously the thicker that wall, the less it's gonna wanna bend.
Right.
However, a lot of them don't load the pilaster. And what I mean by that is the compression of the building is the best friend to the foundation of bending, cracking, or pushing in. So we've got more tension strength to the foundation on a two-story brick home than we do on a single-story frame.
Okay.
Home.
Okay.
And the best way to kind of talk about that, more compression means more tensile or strength. So right now, basically this is gonna be our moment or load. We could push that right over.
Right.
I stand on this and push on it, and it gets much tougher.
I got you.
So the more load that's on the foundation, the stronger the foundation is to cracking or bending.
So a 2 to 3 story home
yep.
is going to have a stronger,
absolutely,
a less weak push-in point.
Correct.
Or so it would bow less.
Absolutely.
Okay. Very good. Very good. Real quick, tell us what tipping is.
Tipping is going to be more so with poured walls. Because the poured wall is going to withstand that, it's not going to be bending in the center like a masonry because you don't have your weak mortar joints.
Gotcha.
So typically that'll act like a retaining wall, and it'll push in. So tipping is going to be more associated with poured walls than CMU.
What can a homeowner do if he's got or she's got a tipping issue? What's one of the ways they can address that?
That's a very good question. I do believe it finally became code around 1987 to have your seal plate and your flooring system anchored. In other words, either steel bands or bolts. Before that, many of the homes, the the framing of the floor and the seal plate are just put on top of it. So all you've got is your load and coefficient friction.
Okay.
So the first thing you want to do is check to see if you've got seal plate anchors in there and whether they're sufficient. If not, there are other anchoring systems that you can use, much like that particular anchoring system there, using the Kevlar that goes to the rim joist or the band board and then over the top of the wall.
Okay, so if I've got a finished basement, the only way I can see if I've got those mm-hmm. is to take the drywall off. But if I've got a crawl space or something like that, I've got a big bolt sticking up with a nut on
That's
top
correct.
Of it. That means that my builder has secured the sill plate
That's
to
correct.
The block.
And
is
that,
that right?
Yes, and that's code now. But previously to, I believe, 1987, it wasn't necessarily code. So the house is just sitting on the foundation.
Right, which is typically a lot of the houses you see that tip are older homes.
Correct.
Is that right?
Okay. Or for instance, with a poured wall, you'll see it tipping when you go to a 40, 55 foot wall. The longer your wall is going to be, the more you're going to have that.
Gotcha.
So I believe code now is 35 feet. They want an offset.
I got you.
The longer your wall, the more she's going to want it.
Because that offset's going to secure
That's
that
correct.
Better. Okay, very good. Well, Todd, appreciate you coming in and talking with us. He came all the way from
Michigan
to talk to us here in Tennessee. So I'm Michael Church with Todd Jackson, Crawl Space Ninja. We hope you make it a happy and blessed day, and we'll see you later.